All right, so with that, we move on to the next session. The next session is another interesting session, things that we all deal with in our day-to-day life, the upside of acting on impulse and trusting your instincts. I'm very sure all of us, you know, we're extremely cautious in decision-making, and sometimes that can hamper the chances of success and leave us, you know, tail-ending, wondering what happened. Trusting your instinct, gut feel as it is called, forms an incredible, an integral part of decisive decision-making. But at the same time, we cannot always be operating from the gut and throw caution to the wind. So over this session, we'll figure out how to strike the fine balance between these decision-making approaches. And to lead this session, we have a very distinguished speaker, Nabomita Mazumdar. Sorry about that. She is a top 100 women achiever awardee by the Ministry of Women and Development of India and the President of India. She's been awarded a lot of honors, top 25 influential women on Twitter, top 20 influencers of by SHRM India. And she is the founder of Nabomita.com, where she amplifies this message to society. And she's an alumnus of XLRI. Nabomita, all yours.
Good afternoon. I'm Nabomita. Thank you, Karanjit, for such a warm welcome. And first of all, thank you, NASSCOM, for getting me here to share acting on impulse. Calcutta is the city of my father. My dad belonged here. So it's a privilege, it's an honor to share how acting on impulse, which every parent doesn't want their child to, is actually driving the industry and can drive your company as well. What is impulse? Impulse is force multiplied by time, right? And it could be anything, a physical action, a thought, right? Can a thought change your world? Can a thought that you get every day actually become a business idea which can run into crores, travel across the globe, and win you awards from the president of your nation? Just one little impulse, right? One tiny stimulation somewhere, it connects you, the nerve connects your brain, the brain lights up, and you have to do it. The passion pushes you. This is one tiny little moment which happened sometime back at Facebook, where two little bots started talking to each other in their own language. Yes, they decided their own language. The programmers who were programming them couldn't identify. Did this tiny little incident change the world? Did this really happen a lot of places where the entrepreneurs were building something and they did not know what the product will turn out? These are two incidents. One, the first picture is Gurgaon, Manesar, wherein out of four factory workers, there's one robo. And of course, then we have Silicon Valley where we have driverless cars. So technology is almost unanimous across the globe. Yes, it may happen in Silicon Valley. It may not take more than 2 to 3 months to catch up in Bangalore and then across everywhere in India. This is four sectors as described by Future of Work. Why are we talking about it? Well, if I understand y'all right, SMEs belong to every sector, right? You have manufacturing, you have technology, you have media. Of course, you also have services. So where is your future going towards? Where is this technology? Those two bots who started deciding to talk, have a conversation of their own, where is this future going for you? Well, as PwC, this is a research by PwC, as they describe it, they have defined the world in four segments. One is, of course, the green world, which is the CSR companies such as Elon Musk is building. Of course, then there is the blue world, which is the identified, stable, organized company, which is not going to tear torn apart by any of the recession or whatever you may call it. Then there is the orange world, a world which is building products for humans. How? Well, the product will decide where if you are ordering a cab using your Ola app, you can choose whether the cab would be driven by he, she, transgender, or maybe a driverless car. That's a product for human being. When you open the refrigerator, the fridge knows what you are going to eat because they have stored in the data. And then there's the red world, which only knows one thing, which is kill everyone to survive. Is your product created for human beings? Do you really allow people to choose through using technology? Or is the technology driving you so much that you have to kill the next product to survive? Again, why are we talking about this? Because there's a bit of AI in everything, right? He just mentioned the device that we are using, and there's a gentleman who questioned that, will the device work on its own? Yes, the devices have started working on its own. There are smartphones who are actually listening to you. There are smart TVs who are listening to the conversation in the room and recording the conversation. You may not know. So what is happening? What is going on? To figure this out, PwC, this is again a report by PwC, wherein they identified three waves. First, algorithm, the normal AI, right? Wherein the internet was drawing data and giving you credit scoring. Second was algorithmic, augmented, sorry, wherein the man and machine worked in tandem together, and you have drones flying across the warehouse. And the final one was autonomous, wherein the machine decides to run itself, and you have to wait till it is ready to serve you. What is this technology doing to us? Well, years back, if we as entrepreneurs, right, wanted to build something, we had to really struggle hard to create an ecosystem. I wonder how many people really had the word ecosystem around if they were trying to build a community product last 10 years back. The first picture is a picture of a network, right, wherein you are in the center point and you have connects. The weak ties is what they describe, with whom you may not have a direct connect, but a connection through connection. Why we are talking about this? Well, we will realize in a while. And then you have a picture over there. There's a lady, right? Her name is Revati Roy. What does she do? At the age of 48, she suddenly lost her husband. She did not have the education to find the job she wanted, and she loved driving cars. She started driving cars. Few years down the line, she built Vira cabs, which she sold for millions. And in the meantime, she created a community of women drivers, creating a safer city in Bombay. What is that? A community for profit. How did she create it? Using technology, using the power to bring people together. The picture that you see, I just want you to remember it for a while. The picture over here is a lady with whom I'm standing. Her name is Rakhi Chabria. Who is she? She's a mother, very worried about her kids' education. She's not happy with what they get in schools. She wants to upgrade teachers, right? Which is the most difficult things, most stubborn industry. EduTech sector, EduTech products, investments happening over there. All comes to a crash when you actually try to build a product. What is she doing? She's actually creating a community of teachers wherein teachers openly share their best of the curriculum through the most innovative way which they are using in their classrooms. And she's just creating this platform wherein the teachers just don't share, they also earn out of it. So what is happening? There is technology. There are people with best of knowledge. And I have seen a product, a competition called Edute Stars, wherein she acknowledged teachers from Bhuj, extreme India, extreme points of India, who are creating, who may not have technology in this classroom, but teaching mathematics, teaching algorithm to students in the most innovative manner. And every information comes in one platform, and anybody can upgrade their education. So of late, yes, she is unfunded. So far, it's not for profit as yet, but I'm sure it will become for profit with profit too, because think of it, what will it do? If you have a community wherein all these edutech products can come together and the teachers are already ready to share, the schools have opened up, we have homeschooling far better than what we have now. Okay, since we talked about community, let me share a story. This is 2006 at XLRI, my final term, and we do have these sessions by our best of the faculties, sharing path-breaking ideas. Communities, 2006 communities were not a word. Community manager was not a job. Even now it is not a job, it's just a social media manager. But anyhow, back then, community manager, nobody knew. But since we had that presentation, whatever community that we were shown, I did not like it. So after the class, I went to a faculty of mine, Dr. Madhukar Shukla, and I said that, sir, I did not like the communities that I saw. He said, no, you don't need to like it. Create one of your own. Create an open community on the internet where everybody can share whatever they want, get everything for free. People come and get their professional advice for free. What did he do? One little impulse, one little idea. that changed my life. In two months, I Googled and I found CiteHR, just as you must have logged into Facebook. I logged into CiteHR as a member, but in a few months, I created offline chapters and I joined hands with the person who was building it. In next 4 years, I moonlight and I kept building the community. In next 6 years, I joined in next 4 years' time, I joined the community as a partner. It took me 10 years to create a community of 3 million, which was the largest community for HR from our living rooms using technology, just two people serving 1.5 lakh, more than that, people online every day. What was it? Technology, information available right at the point of time when they need it, people brought together for a reason, and of course, evangelism. What is evangelism and why is it important to you? If you're an SME, if you're running a company, why should you value, why should you matter? For example, NASSCOM is a community, right? Can you create, as an SME, a community of your own wherein you have not just your customers to turn or your prospective customers to buy your products, but you also have a community for vendors. You have the information sharing so strong that the first thing that they would do, that your vendors would do, is to wake up in the morning and go to your community, because every information related to the product or the business or the service they are doing is available in their in that one particular place. This is just technology. This is just using internet. This is just using AI. You put the data together. How do you do it? How do you, first and foremost, how does this help? Well, through my experience, I saw community. Even though I started it out of an impulse, it was getting me the pulse of my industry. And hopefully it will get yours too. So this is what your community can create for you. First, obviously, you just create an awareness of who is doing whom. You create a gelling between the people. You share information. Then they start considering that, okay, fine, he's doing something, his company. Well, we are also dealing with many other clients, but he's also good, and we are also buying from many other people, but he's also good. Obviously, they'll start preferring once the consideration is there. Purchase, loyalty, the biggest thing is advocacy. Most of us as organization owners stop at purchase. We don't look beyond that. Obviously, after sales service takes our money, but we do not focus on something called advocacy. Advocacy is your branding beyond what you can create through your PR, through your social media, and any investment that you can make. Why a branded community? Why do you need a branded community for you? For example, there are a couple of SMEs, right, who I interacted with. One was financial institution. They are just offering different kind of loans for motor vehicle. They have all the data of who's looking for what, at what point of time, why should I buy this bike, what amount of money do I need to spend. All they had to do is to bring them together, bring all these people together, make the information so relevant using AI that nobody needs to Google. Google give you a million search on one click. You don't need to go there. A community gets you connected, referred information. If you have to make a real big purchase, would you go to Google or would you go to your store or would you ask a friend? So that's exactly what a community can create, more than a friend, because there are people who are doing the same work. Of course, it is better than social media because it's gated, it's far more refined, and it has your... Most of these data shares that it's the ice cream moment, right? The ice cream parlor moment. You walk into an ice cream parlor on a hot day and you buy an ice cream, you don't even think twice. If you are selling a motor car, if you are selling, maybe you're into logistics, right? And a freight forwarding company tried building a community. Why? Because they're into shipping. And they are just probably an Uber for ships. What are they doing? They have all the data of which ship is moving towards which direction, which is the truck that is going to come to which port. They know, they have the entire information. They just connect the people together. They build in such a strong network that people actually listen to each other before reaching out or calling up some agent, asking and negotiating for rates. And think about it. Impulsive buying. Well, these are the three segments which has been identified for impulsive buying. Whether you are B2C or B2B, doesn't matter. whether you are selling just a 10 rupee product or a 1 crore product, you still have that ice cream parlor moment at your product. You still have that one little moment which is the threshold for your client. What impulsive buying shows, if you have a community, the entire information remains in there. The entire trust, loyalty is there. Your community will not go out of the gated area. Through site HR, I remember people who used to site HR, they used to talk to me even 10 years later that, yes, yesterday I put a question in that community. It was an online discussion forum. They gave me an answer in 5 minutes. So the kind of reference that you build is stronger than any marketing, any PR, any media work that you can create. One banner at probably in front of the airport that I saw can cost you lakhs. Think about building this community and spending some time wherein all these people are gelled to your product. Even if they are not buying, they will refer if you have their loyalty. These are top five B2C products. Irrespective of it, even if you are selling a smartwatch or maybe an intelligence device, a friend of mine, he has a data product, right? And his product can show in one click on how Elon Musk, his data on the internet is showing. And Elon Musk's team uses similar kind of a tool to identify what is the information about him on the internet. You must have heard about an incident, tiny incident, wherein Elon Musk was doping in a live podcast, and that really hit the business. That really pulled the shares down. In 5 minutes, his team could detect before the entire internet could identify, and before a greater damage could be done, the team worked on the information and pushed the entire information so positive that people actually started believing, okay, fine, he must have smoked, he's not a bad guy. The shares shouldn't fall further. Before my time is over, this is one request to y'all. I'm sure y'all are using social media somewhere. I'm sure y'all are building communities even without realizing, building networks even without realizing it. This is a request, which a campaign, effort by the government of your nation, wherein they are trying to acknowledge the women who are creating this difference on the internet. So all you have to do is, you have to nominate these women who are making this difference. Probably they do not even know that the internet has had that power which can get them acknowledged to this level. You just have to go to that hashtag or the ministry's Twitter handle and nominate them. Why is this important? No effort, unless and until it is acknowledged, will be repeated. So this is your time. Yes, you can build the community. Yes, you can create the product, raise an investment, create even greater product and a great success story. But this is one tiny effort which will not cost you anything. Men in the room, women in the room, just go and nominate somebody. Nominate yourself if you're a woman and get acknowledged for it. The difference that you have created using people, using technology, using community, all the best. Before I end. Thank you.
Thanks, Nabomita, for that great session on acting on impulse and trusting your instincts. I hope all of us have some way to figure out where to use gut and where to further drill down. I would request Sangeeta Raj from NASSCOM to please hand over a memento. Thank you.